Hi everyone. Good afternoon, evening. Welcome to this special talk that we're having with Jordan Demetrius Lloyd regarding his new experimental documentary, Trip Gloss, which was commissioned by Baryshnikov Art Center. The world premiere was last week, November 29th, 2021, and the film is available to stream through December 13th. My name is Benedict, Nguyễn. My pronouns are they, them, theirs. I am a light-skinned Vietnamese person with wavy black hair. I'm wearing a loud lime green shirt and dark red lipstick. And I have the pleasure of chatting with friend and collaborator.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jordan Demetrius Lloyd, as Benedict shared. I am a dancer, teacher, choreographer, performer. I use he, him, his pronouns. I am in Brooklyn, New York, so I'm on the land of the Lenape people. And just a little bit about myself, I graduated from the College of Rockport in Western New York. And shortly after, moved to New York City. At that time, I was dancing with David Dorfman Dance, but over the years have worked with several different choreographers and started teaching quite regularly. That's a pretty big part of my practice. So that's me.
Great. I forgot to mention that I'm broadcasting through the Zoom from the South Bronx, New York, Lenape and Wappinger lands. And yeah, let's talk about this film, Jordan.
Sure, yes.
Do you want to tell us about the process for developing it? How did it come to be? What were your initial visions for this project?
Yes. I mean, I think when I was approached or invited into conversation with BAC, the conversation was sort of immediately centered around a digital commission and what that meant. And I guess creating something that felt like it was speaking to, in conversation with, or at least aware of those circumstances. And so having made a couple of works already for the digital world, right? This was about a year and change into the pandemic. I think my immediate vision was to really slow down and, I guess, look at the screen, the sort of like two-dimensional screen, as a framework for understanding what I do, which is creating live performance. And the on a sort of like nuanced level, what things are shifting and changing as I'm traditionally making in for live performance and now making for the 2D screen. Fast forward, we set up a residency so that I could be in the space with my artist or with the collaborators that I'm working with. And I invited people in to start documenting our time there. And there was sort of a conversation or a moment in this process where I imagined making something perhaps more like film centered or cinematic. The intent was not always to make something like a documentary, but that's sort of where we landed, and we can get into that a little bit more later. Mm-hmm. That's how it sort of like came to be.
You mentioned the other films that you've made over this pandemic, The Last Moon in Mellowland, which you and I worked on together, as well as Williamson, which premiered earlier this calendar year. I was wondering if you could talk about, more about how those thread together, where they diverge, and Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure you remember a little bit, just like the conversations before creating The Last Moon in Mellowland, which was, the first thing that I created inside of the pandemic. And in many ways, that was like a survival project. Like I just felt that my environment, our collective environment and experience had sort of been pulled and stretched in such extreme ways that like I needed somewhere to sort of like process and dump my thoughts and maybe my desires for like humanity, for like what I felt we maybe needed collectively at the time. And so there was very little thought around what does it mean to make a film, right, as a dance artist. And a lot of my focus for that project was like on working with people, on acknowledging sort of like the specific like energy or essence of the moment, the particular quietude that sort of like seeped into my life and my experience at the time. And then you fast forward to a project like Williamson, which, you know, The Last Moon of Mellowland, just to give some context, is about 74, I think, shots, different shots in about 23 minutes. So there are clips and images that you're only living with for about 7 seconds, and they're moving really fast. It's sort of a collage of a lot of information I was collecting at the time. Whereas Williamson, which is something that I made for the draft work series at Dance Space Project, I decided to do one shot. I was like very disinterested in setting up my camera at 8 different angles and figuring out how to get like the perfect sexy shot from of the material. It felt like too much or something. Like it felt easier for me to maybe set up one frame to really pay attention to what that frame was and to create an experience where the bodies are moving in and out of that frame, similar to like, I guess, how my hands are moving in and out of this square. And so both of those projects felt like I wasn't really thinking too critically about the fact that we were on a two-dimensional screen. There were things that I noticed, like observations, and maybe I developed some tools, right? Like I think that things like read a little bit more like exciting and virtuosic if we contoured the body, if there was a way of sort of like animating and exaggerating like different postures for the two-dimensional screen that I think made it a little bit more legible. So there were, you know, the thinking was there, but my attention, which for me feels like it's like a spotlight, I wasn't shining it on that. So I guess, yeah, those two leading me to this project where I really sort of like shifted that spotlight on the two-dimensional screen, and specifically thinking about sort of like time, space, and sensation. Did that answer your question?
Absolutely.
Okay.
You always answer the question. And I'm always following along. Can you walk us to that residency week at BAC where you're in the space, you're in your collaborators, what happens? Who are you working with, and what do you discover?
Yeah, totally. It feels like a good opportunity to just name the 5 people that are in the film. They are listed in the credits and briefly at the beginning. But I was working with Wendell Gray II, Mia Martelli, Kennedy Thomas, Jose Lapas Rodriguez, and Michael Nairn. That always happens. There's a lot of them. Sorry. And I was working with Ryan Wolf, who came for short periods of time, but several times throughout the week to score this entire film. And yeah, I mean, I mentioned this earlier that I thought I was making something cinematic that felt like a film. And I think leading up to the residency, the climate was shifting. I don't know if folks can remember back to August and September, like we are sort of phasing out of the summer heat and this like newly vaxxed energy. And the world was like, at least I felt I was being reminded of this very serious state that we were all still existing in. And so I remember we had a meeting on Zoom leading up to the week and just sort of collectively made the decision to not put too much pressure on this week, and that it felt sort of extraordinary that we were even able to gather and we were able to like come into the space and be in an indoors room together for such a concentrated amount of time. And that really informed the conversation that I had with the two folks that came in to film, that at one point I was thinking about setting up a tripod and getting really specific shots of certain sections, which there are shards of that in the documentary. But for the most part, I just told them to work handheld and to capture things that they felt were interesting. And I can't tell you how much footage I have from that week. It's kind of absurd, the amount of information that I had to sift through. But I appreciated it in that it took a lot of pressure off of feeling like we needed to produce something specific. It was more like, let's just come together, find sort of like rigor and momentum, and we'll find a way to be intentional with what we're left with, right? At the end of the week, all this footage, all this information, whatever we find, like there's a way to shape it and turn it into something that I think still has like weight and meaning. And in this circumstance, it was a documentary, which I'm really excited about.
Yeah, it's a beautiful film. I got to see a clip, a few weeks before it premiered. I've seen the full thing twice. And when you made the pivot, I was so curious, and I'm sure folks in the room are as well. How did you, what brought documentary as a form, as a medium to mind? When you have, 6 days times two cameras times how many hours a day is worth mm-hmm. the footage, like, mm-hmm. What was that thought process like for you?
I was watching a lot of dance at the time. I was watching my friends, my peers, people who I'm inspired by. There were so many digital commissions happening that I felt that I was really in a practice of looking at movement on the screen. And in many ways, it sort of had become like really normalized. And so much of this project felt like it was about the conversations that were happening in the room. Not only about the scores that we created, but the sort of process of building the scores and thinking about them. And I guess as I was reviewing footage, because there's plenty of footage where I'm not speaking, there's plenty of footage that it could totally look like we're running a 20-minute dance that is set and it is grounded, and I could have spliced that together. And it felt like there was something missing. It immediately started to feel like another dance film. And a lot of the ways I think that I was thinking about the material feels heightened by the process nature of the documentary, by our conversations, by the sort of like rehearsal energy of it. I think that's something that I'm, talking about with my collaborators, I think, is like, how do we really stay present inside of movement material, so that as we move through, say, like a phrase, it feels like we're making sort of like active decisions about what's happening in the body, that there's a sort of like subjectivity that comes into the space, into the performance. And that's something that felt like it kind of just like got washed away when it was just movement. I became really sort of fascinated seeing them work through that, like the labor of like sitting with something, touching your fingers, like really paying attention to the sensation of the fingertips. And I think what I was interested in is like, can this translate when I'm not in front of them, when there isn't this sort of like describable space between me and them, and it's the relationship shifts.
And so how did you, what did showing, that space between your collaborators and yourself, what did that bring you as you were working that into the edit? And I think this is like kind of zooming back to what you were inviting videographers of your own, like not happy Wednesday brain fry, but like videographers that you already knew
and have
been in collaboration with.
I guess I'm sort of thinking about, I want to clarify. I'm thinking specifically about like the space between me and the performers. And are we talking about sort of like how my thinking around that informs some of the decisions about like space that like landed in the film? Or are you thinking more specifically about the way that things were captured and sort of the depth between the camera and their bodies? Maybe both.
Both.
I felt that. totally.
Connect any threads you'd like. No, yeah. Mm-hmm. And if none are apparent, no worries.
No, I hear you. I think there's a lot of like richness there. Yeah, I mean, I think about this stuff a lot. Like, I used to, in college, I remember there was like a big sort of like agenda of like, no, like we want to make process-based work. It's like, it's not about the product. And I remember always feeling a sort of tension with that because I was really thinking about the moment that the dance has like landed in front of a group of people. I was like sort of religiously holding that in the back of my head that like there would come a time where like a bunch of people would sit somewhere organized or not, and that we would be this sort of like central point of focus, and that when like in those circumstances I feel that there is a sort of like palpable activation of space right between the performers and the viewers. And so when I'm in the studio, or when I was in the studio this week with these collaborators, I think I was trying to really heighten the movement material and the information in a way that made that at least was like in conversation with that space, right? Mm-hmm. Like, which I think was really informed by sort of like focus. And there's several clips where performers are sort of like looking up or looking off to the camera. And we brought a lot of like imagery and imagination into the space so that we were giving information and context to a world outside of their bodies, like a world that was like constructed that this work was existing in. And for me, that somehow informs and activates this space, right? Whether or not I'm a part of the world or I'm peripheral and I'm kind of like have this outsider's perspective, it feels more legible or something, I think, when there is an attention to what we're seeing, how the sensation of the material, performative intention. So I think that that's how I was sort of like chewing on space in the studio in process. And then with the two videographers that were brought in, I think they were pretty peripheral. Like I think it was out of like respect, right? Like not wanting to like disrupt the space or get in anyone's way. They sort of like stayed on the periphery. And I think it was around Wednesday or like, you know, midweek that I really was like, I think we can like shake that up. I think you can get close. I think we can find moments of intimacy and we can find moments where we're like, you know, highlighting the sweat on people's faces, or we're cutting off from the neck down. So we're really only focusing on someone's like head and how and what they're seeing. And I guess that just added to like the variety of shots, right, that I was able to choose from in the end. And I think that this is true, but I want to say that I think that there's a bit of both of like close up intimate shots, and then there's shots where there's a lot of distance. And then there's one section that which we really call runway, right, where dancers are coming, walking directly towards sort of the camera, that is in direct conversation with this, right? Like the way that my hand is back here, and then it's going to get bigger as it gets close to the screen, and then it gets small again. Like that's something that is really unique in this circumstance of the screen, of the laptop, right? Like, mm-hmm. if I was in front of you, you'd be like, you're just pushing your hand toward me. I don't know that my hand would read as that much bigger. So,
right.
Yeah.
To this space, you know, between, and I will keep it intentionally that vague because I feel like from what I know of you, you're not trying to call that space a thing.
Yeah, but right.
I'm curious if you could talk about some of the other devices that you use that to me brought attention to that space. I'm thinking your play with color, like all of those bright flashing neon that we see interspersed throughout, mm-hmm. your work with sound, your use mm-hmm. of certain filters over the original footage. You don't have to address all three of those at once, but yeah.
Totally.
Whatever comes to mind, how are those in play?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think that they're like, maybe this is something that I've discovered, and I feel like as a field, we've really taken advantage of all the like amazing technology that's out there. Like, you can do so much with a video and some of the editing softwares that exist. And I was weary of getting too sort of like caught up in all this land or world of possibilities, and felt it easier to identify like three or four tools that I would use. And I wanted them to be like really simple tools, like the color changing from yellow to purple, you know, going from this like comic book animation sort of filter to a regular screen, which I'm learning maybe is a little bit like sneakier or more like miragey than I intended. I guess I just was interested in, to some extent, sustaining attention throughout. I feel like whenever I'm like poking at something new, there's like an anxiety that like that people are just gonna become like disinterested, or like that, I don't know, that whatever I'm trying to do won't be received. And I felt like a way to sustain attention was to keep toying with what people were seeing. And like I said, I had laid out these tools. So changing the coloring of a shot in a moment, right? I think does keep us tuned in, potentially even like waiting for the next manipulation or the next sort of like edit or effect that's going to come in. And then once the tools are there and there's sort of like a system of like integrating those tools into the work, it felt like a way of composing that is familiar, that I'm aware of, right? That like, I'm like, oh, this is just figuring out like what, like the sequence, right? When do we see the thing? And then additionally, like, how, like, what is the texture of it? The same way that we would coach like quality of movement, right, in live performance, felt similar to me choosing, is it yellow or is it purple? Does it start right like with the original shot, and then does it go to animation, or is it actually the inverse of that? There's like this one moment where Wendell is landing a jump, and for like truly like 0.4 seconds it's animated. And up until I sent the film in, it was always the opposite. The whole shot was animated, and for that 0.4 seconds it was. So it's like there's like a an intuitive logic, right, that I'm sort of like calling on when I start to watch the thing. I start to watch the thing over and over and over, and I'm trying to look at the work and ask like, what does it need? And I start to make decisions about that. And so all of these tools that you're naming, sound, color, the animation, I think were just attempts to keep people tuned in. Because I feel like if they're tuned in, the information will translate. The sensation will translate. When we slow down, right, there's that gorgeous shot of Michael sort of like looking up, rubbing her fingers. Like, would we be able to slow down with her, right? And really arrive at this like stretched out moment, this intimate moment. And then sort of like be slung shot into like a section of all of us running together and like working on a score that's based in like that motion. And I wanted people to be sensitive to that, to the sequencing, to the editing. And I think the introduction helps, the flashes of color. I think it's like, it like sets a tone, or it like almost is like, a, I don't know, like, I'm lost for the word at the moment, but I do think that it like tells us something about what we might, what we might see. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Could I sing your praises for like one sentence?
Yes.
or like what I'm hearing is like, you're very aware of like all the beauty that you captured in your footage. And so like, what you're like, the editing was super intentional to highlight some of those moments and ask viewers to notice things that might have, you know, get lost in other compositional forms.
Yeah, I would agree, and I appreciate you saying that. There was a lot of beautiful footage. It was a lot. It was hard to not just like, yeah, put that out and just be like, okay, here you go. Like, I really, I had to like keep reminding myself that this project is about something else as well.
Where's the director's cut?
Uh-oh, okay, yeah. A different time.
Yeah, we're gonna wind down. Is there anything else that you wanted to share about the work, about what else you're working on with the audience tonight?
I'm still working with this group of collaborators, and I've actually welcomed an additional collaborator, Bree Breeden, into the room. And so we are working up to something that I think will come in the spring or early summer. I really can't share much more than that. I think given the state of the world, it's really difficult to plan long-term. But gratitude to those people that were in the documentary with me, and Ryan and Benedict, and so many people hold me artistically. And I feel very grateful to have this sort of like team of incredibly talented people with me.
Beautiful. Speaking of, forgot to acknowledge, thank Kat Cordona, our ASL interpreter, who's also on your screen. Thank you so much for supporting this talk. Thanks to everyone at BAC for supporting the film and this talk. And thank you to the audience for joining us this evening, and take care. Good night.
Thanks, Benedict.
Thank you, Jordan.